So good evening, everyone. Good evening. Welcome to our Ethics in Society speaker series. Thank you all so much for coming out tonight, and it's great to have you all here on this beautiful May evening. My name is Dr. Jim Hornstein. I am the chairman of the Community Memorial Health System Bioethics Committee, and it is my absolute pleasure again to moderate tonight's tasty topic on gluten and red meat and GMOs, oh my, the ethics of eating. Before we begin, please join me in thanking our sponsor for this evening, the Community Memorial Health System. And for those who don't know, this is a health system which has been serving up great medical and preventive care in addition to delicious and nutritious food since 1902. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause for our also hot off the press, something that I didn't know until today. And I'd like to make these remarks specifically to Community Memorial Hospital and Ojai Community Hospital. You may or may not know, but this is National Hospital Week. And there is a full page ad in today's Star. And what I'd like to do, it's May 8th through May 14th, 2016. What I would like to say to our sponsors, and this is really both as a physician who's practiced in this town, a father whose all three kids were born at Community Hospital, and also had the wonderful opportunity to collaborate with them on so many wonderful projects, I really do wish to Community Memorial Hospital and Ojai Community Hospital a happy National Hospital Week day to them, because they both have done so much to improve the lives and the health of all of us in Western Ventura County. So, happy National Hospital Week. Finally, a special thanks to our hosts who are present tonight and who have been present at all of our talks over the past years: Mike Ellenson, the Vice President of Community Memorial Health Systems in Marketing and Development, and also Mary McCormick in the back, who is the Marketing Manager. In addition to their entire first-class production team, they have been here every step of the way, and again, they have been wonderful to work with, and I'd like to acknowledge their excellent work and their support. So let's begin. I'm sure all of you have heard of the expression, you are what you eat. Some of you are eating right now. You may be becoming what you're eating. We've all heard that expression, you are what you eat, but let's think about it for a second. What does that really mean? I think it's saying that every day we make choices about what we put in our mouths, and those choices can and do really, really matter. We all know that our food choices can seriously impact our bodies and even our overall health, but also that these food choices can affect our moods, our relationships, and even our personalities. So if we are truly what we eat, shouldn't all of us strive to choose foods that make us feel good and make us feel happy? Sure makes sense to me. So recently, while I was preparing for this talk, I decided to go out and find the perfect happy meal. And I found it. But after I got it, I wondered if happiness was the only value important to eating and our health. This was my happy meal. And I was wondering, shouldn't I also be thinking about limiting red meat or fat, or my sugar intake? So I decided to keep searching and went to the local supermarket to look for more classic foods, and I was able to find this. It says classic. And it also says it's party side, and come on now, who in this room doesn't like to have a party? But after I saw this, I started to wonder, maybe there's more than just classic and party. And something right next to it caught my eye, and that was veggie chips, okay? And I actually purchased those. Here's the package, okay? Because after all, haven't we all been told to eat more veggies? Didn't our mothers tell us that? But also, I want to read about this. It says, this is breaking news. Ladies and gentlemen, we've got breaking news tonight. We have to read all about it. And this was in my chip, and I'm quoting, it is gluten-free, vegan, kosher, halal, non-GMO, no MSGs, no dairy, no artificial ingredients, no artificial flavors or coloring, no hydrogenated fats, and 0 grams trans fats. Sounds pretty good, doesn't it? The bag was empty. I thought it sounded pretty good, but I still didn't know it because even though there was a lot of important stuff written on the package, will those things really make me happy? So actually, I got a little confused as to what to buy, and I decided to turn, as is common, at least in my profession, to doctors who I respect for their advice and their expertise. Of course, the first doctor I turned to was Dr. Pepper, as you can see, a doctor who's been in practice for over 130 years. But unfortunately, I found there wasn't much written on the packaging to help me, so I didn't think that was much help. Fortunately, I was referred to Dr. Prager, and Dr. Prager was very helpful because he wrote a lot on his package, which were selling broccoli cakes. And as you can see, they were gluten-free, non-GMO, and even kosher. But if you are what you eat, as I said we were earlier, do I really want to be a broccoli cake? I didn't think so. Desperately, I turned to another authoritative-looking doctor. This one is Dr. Cracker. Now, I don't know about you, but doesn't Dr. Cracker look like he's currently practicing in 19th century Vienna? Dr. Cracker isn't exactly on the staff currently at Community Memorial Health System. But I thought this was great because there was a lot of important looking stuff written all over the package. Lots of protein, lots of fiber, whole grains, non-GMO, it's certified organic, and there was no sugar. So what's not to like? Well, unfortunately, the taste. I tasted this cracker, and it just didn't make me feel happy. So I became frustrated and a little bit overwhelmed with all this labeling stuff and with all the food choices, and I wondered to myself, when did eating become so complicated? I was in the market, and I frankly lost my appetite, but my wife asked me to pick up some dog food before I came home. So I went to the dog food department, and oh my gosh, unbelievable, not here too, there is Mary's Pet Organic Free Range Nutrition for Dogs Non-GMO Dog Food. As I mentioned, there were no antibiotics. As you can see, it's non-GMO, free range, it's organic, no hormones, it's considered air-chilled, and no added water in the pet food. Now, come on now. How am I possibly, and you, supposed to balance the benefits of verified non-GMO in our animal, our little dog, who spends the majority of his day chewing his butt and drinking out of the toilet? I also questioned, as you can see on the bottom, no added water. I think my dog added water. So I thought, enough already. I don't know about you, but I felt I needed help figuring out what to buy, what to eat, and what's really important. Fortunately, tonight, we have 4 excellent speakers who can help sort out the increasingly complicated world of eating and nutrition. So please join me as we introduce our first speaker, Mrs. Karen Kiefer. Karen was born and raised in Yonkers, New York. She received her bachelor's degree in dietetics from SUNY, the State University of New York in Oneonta. She received her master's in nutritional science from Cal State University at Northridge. Her current position, her job, is director of food and nutrition services at our own Community Memorial Health System. A fun fact about Karen, which you may not know, is she enjoys pickleball, of which I have no idea what that is.
Not GMO.
Not GMO. Karen will speak tonight on understanding the food lingo. Ladies and gentlemen, Mrs. Karen Kiefer.
Well, gee, I don't know if I can top that. I've been with the hospital for a couple of years. I've been in administrative dietetics for over 15 years. So I haven't given a talk in a while, and Dr. Hornstein kept coming down to our dietitians and said, what do you think about this? What do you think about that? And eventually when he came down, I was the only one that was left. You know, and he goes, come on, can we get you to talk? I said, I can talk, you know. So tonight, I have the great pleasure of talking about the three things tonight, and that is gluten, and then GMOs, and trans fats. So I'm going to talk about what they are. I bet our audience probably knows better than anyone, has a lot of interesting questions, but let's get started. Okay, so what is gluten? Gluten, as you can see here, it's the inner core of a wheat kernel, okay? It's made up of two proteins, gliadin and glutenin. So the gluten actually has a very important function. It assists in helping baked products or any other of those manufactured products maintain their shape and keep foods together. It's kind of like a glue, okay? So who needs to avoid gluten, okay? You have four basic types of people or subpopulations that need to avoid gluten. And that is someone with a wheat allergy, okay? Usually those are children. And about less than 1% of children in the United States have a true wheat allergy. When they grow up, about 65% of them actually outgrow that allergy. And then sometimes adults will have a wheat allergy. A lot of times, from what I've seen, it's from excessive exercise. Sometimes that brings it on. But there is testing available. The second one is dermatitis herpetiformis. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. So what you see is it's a skin rash. That could be mild to no stomach reactions, okay? So basically, these people have itching and burning and blisters, okay? Those are usually 15 to 25%, and they occur in those with celiac, okay? So celiac is something, is our next category, and about 1% of the population in the United States has celiac disease. Okay, there is a test for it. I could tell you that what happens in the intestinal villi, there are like finger-like projections in your intestine. And those finger-like projections absorb the minerals and the nutrients and the vitamins. And what happens in someone that has celiac is they have diarrhea, they usually have weight loss, gas, bloating, okay? They're also been known to have chronic fatigue, very tired. And they also have neurological problems, too. I could tell you my uncle was finally diagnosed with celiac disease when he was 65. They didn't know what it was. But when he was finally diagnosed, it opened up a new world for him. He started gaining weight. And it was years and years that it did take. And they actually found out through the elimination of foods, and then he reincorporated these foods. And that was probably about, 20, 30 years ago. Then there's also non-celiac gluten sensitivity. And that occurs in about 6% of the U.S. population. And most of these people have the same symptoms as celiac disease, but what they find out is if they do avoid gluten, that decreases the symptoms. And they have the same symptoms as celiac disease. Sometimes people with irritable bowel find if they avoid gluten, that does help them. So what foods contain gluten? I thought you'd like that. Basically anything that has wheat, barley, and rye, okay? You see a lot of those asterisks up there? They may contain gluten, right? Isn't that a definitive answer? Okay, the reason why they may contain gluten is how they're processed or what they're made with. Okay, that's very important. So you might not know exactly what you're getting. You really have to read your ingredients list. Next, there are choices. There are gluten-free flours. Okay, I've never seen so many gluten-free flours on the market. When you go into Whole Foods or Lassen's Foods, they have so many gluten-free flours. This is an idea of what ones are available, what their color is, and what their flavor is like. However, in a 2005 report from the Academy of Nutrition and Dietetics, they said most of these choices can be lower in B vitamins, calcium, iron, zinc, and fiber. I have actually made products with corn flour, rice flour, and soy flour. I don't know if anybody out there has, but it doesn't taste the same. Probably because your palate is used to tasting wheat flour, okay? Also, the texture is not the same, but it can be done. And then, you know what? My son has dated actually 3 women who have been gluten-free, and they haven't worked out. So, he is going to avoid this website, Gluten-Free Singles. The problem is, a lot of people are actually going gluten-free when they really don't need to, okay? We never really want to tell anybody, well, don't do that. You know, you really believe that it works for you and you don't have any of those symptoms that were up there, go for it. But if you're going to date my son, you have to eat gluten. Okay? So next, what I want to talk about are GMOs. So what is a GMO, or genetically modified organism? Okay, well, what happens with that? GMO is actually a living plant, a living being. It could be a plant, it could be an animal, it could be a single organism. And it has its DNA changed or modified. The genes of one species are removed and then placed into the genes of another. So genetically, you see the DNA structure? Modified, adding or removing the genes, and then organisms planted into something else. So why the concern? Well, GMOs in food can make crops more resistant to freezing, to bruising, to insects, and browning. So for instance, tomatoes have been developed that actually resist frosting and actually resist cold temperatures because they also have been injected with genes from cold water winter flounder. Pretty interesting, huh? So that's the benefit. You know, farmland has been shrinking more and more, and we need to produce more and more, okay? But there are concerns, and those concerns are cross allergies, disruption of the ecosystem, and possibly new diseases. So with allergies, you know, you're taking some of the genes that are used in this technology, and they're taken from a food or something else that already causes an allergy in someone else. So you're put, and you don't know exactly what gene right now they're getting it from. They're inserting that gene into another organism that could host the organism to express that allergen as a trait. Gabish? Yeah. Okay. So, what foods are genetically modified? Well, I don't know of all of them. They're not labeled. Okay. But what's most prevalent is that 95% of sugar beets, 94% of soy, 93% of canola oil, 90% of cottonseed, and 88% of corn are now genetically modified. In 2012, so here we have something that's kind of pro. You see the first cartoon? You see Snow White? You know, she's reading the label on the apple. And she says, I don't think so, Grandma. Have you seen what they put in these things? So you know what? She's not going to take that temptation. Okay, so truth in labeling actually spoil yet another perfectly good fairy tale. Okay, and then the con side, you see a fish. The regular fish are trying to keep up with the genetically modified fish because he's got what? He's got a propeller. And he says, how are we supposed to compete with this genetically modified salmon, right? Okay, so in 2012, Californians rejected Prop 37. All right, that would have required labeling of genetically modified foods. It was defeated by a narrow margin. It was defeated with 51.4% of the vote. The voters said no. And it's a hot button in the Senate right now. Last year in July, the House passed a bill blocking states from requiring GMO labels on food because the FDA says that they're safe. I'm just giving you the facts, okay? So think about that. Okay, next we wanna talk about trans fats. Finally, we wanna talk about trans fats. So what are trans fats? Okay, it's also known as a trans fatty acid. And there are two types. One, the first type actually is naturally occurring. There are found trace amounts in animals. That's a fact. Very small amounts. There's also been some literature there that says they really don't have a damaging effect. But however, most are made from food processing. It's a process called hydrogenation. It adds hydrogen to those molecules, and it changes the chemical structure. And this is the reason why there's concern. Well, what's all the fuss? What's the problem? Well, here's what happens to trans fats in the body. Good cholesterol, HDL, is picked up, and excess cholesterol and transported. And it goes back to the body's liver for processing. consuming trans fats actually lowers the HDL or the good cholesterol, okay? But there's another thing, and it's connected to the bad cholesterol. LDLs, or your bad cholesterol, transports it throughout the body. As cholesterol builds up in the walls of the body's arteries, the arteries become narrower and harden, and it reduces the blood flow, and it leads to an increased chance of a heart attack or cardiovascular disease, okay? There are other types of fat, but trans fats and actually saturated fats are probably the most damaging. So, what foods contain trans fat? Looks good, right? All the good stuff, that's right. Trans fats were originally used by companies because they give a desired taste, they give a desired texture, they were inexpensive, they increased the shelf life of foods. What you don't see in this picture actually are potato chips, okay? And actually you see margarine there, okay? There's an ongoing debate about butter and margarine. The best thing that is usually recommended with dietitians is to look for a soft margarine, okay? Margarine free from trans fats is really ideal. So what's recommended? 1% of your total calories should be from trans fats. So in other words, if you have a 2,000 calorie diet, only 20 calories, okay? Or 2 grams, or a quarter of a cookie, or 2 potato chips, and you're done for the day. Yum, yum. Okay, so we want to get into a little bit about truth in labeling, okay? What are the rules? So if the food has 0.5 grams of trans fat per serving, it can be listed on a food label as zero. Uh-huh. But then that's why you want to check the ingredients. See, here it says zero trans fats, but if you look at the ingredients, something like partially hydrogenated vegetable oil and hydrogenated oils, those are trans fats. Not another. Okay. I got a little funny cartoon here. All right. What are you in for? Double murder. And you? Well, I sold trans fats. Okay. So in 2013, the FDA made a preliminary determination that trans fats were no longer generally recognized as safe. The FDA is now taking final action and determining that trans fats are not generally recognized and safe, and they're not for use in any human food. So they are trying to take steps to remove artificial trans fat from the food supply. But guess what they're using? Palm oil. High in saturated fat. Yeah, it's natural. Oh. But that's also going to raise your levels. So that ends my portion. Thank you.
Everybody depressed yet? Our second speaker, I'm delighted to introduce Dr. Greg Koshan. Greg was born in Detroit and raised in Miami, Florida. He received his bachelor's degree in chemistry from the University of Miami. He received his master's degree in synthetic organic chemistry from San Francisco State University, and finally his doctorate, his PhD in chemistry from Purdue. He is currently the director of the Ventura Bio Center, Ventura County's only biology technology startup innovator. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome Dr. Greg Koshan.
Hi, I want to thank Dr. Hornstein and Community Memorial for inviting me here to speak to you today about GMOs, the good, the bad, and the ugly. And I want to thank Karen as well for introducing some of the early topics, because I've got way too many slides, and this will just slow down the rate at which I have to skip over them. So I beg your indulgence, and if you have any questions, I'll be around later so you can ask me if I've skipped over a slide that you wanted to hear more about. So just a little bit about me. Dr. Hornstein mentioned the early stuff, so I'll skip that. Worked at a couple of companies, came to Amgen, fortunately, and worked as a research scientist for a number of years. I left in 2005 to start a new lab, president of Amethyst Life Sciences now, which helps set up startup companies. Founded the Ventura Bio Center in 2012 as a place for companies to get started. And we started Exilico just a couple of years ago for high-performance 3D printing materials. I advise a couple of startup companies and materials science plays, and I help coach the Thousand Oaks High School science students for the science fair, and I'm a judge at the fair as well. But I am always looking for an excuse to get back into the lab and have fun. I want to point out I am not an agri-scientist, as was stated in the ad, so if you came to hear an actual agri-scientist, sorry, it's not me. Just a shameless plug for the Bio Center. We are Ventura County's bio/technology startup incubator. Really, we're about half biotech or life sciences and half other kinds of startups, electronics and 3D printing. We're founded on the fields of science and education and business. And what we do is we put all these together in an R&D facility, which is equipped to build competitive companies. We're trying to build a sustainable technology economy here in Ventura County. So a bit of background, I think, which Karen kind of covered well. I just want to mention the central dogma, which you may have heard of. DNA goes to RNA, goes to protein, right? It's the information flow. So you see the DNA inside the nucleus, it's transcribed to RNA, and then it becomes proteins, made into proteins. I have to go fast because I want to cover a lot. So a recombinant DNA technology, you know, the kind of stuff that Amgen does. Typically, you have a gene that you want to express in something, and it might have it in a, so you have a gene in a cell, say you have a human cell, and you want to clone this gene or you want to express it. The human growth hormone is the example that's given here. So you use enzymes which cut DNA. They're called endonucleases or DNases. One is mentioned there, ECOR1, that's an endonuclease, restriction endonuclease. You cut the gene that you want out of the entire chromosome of DNA, and then you use other enzymes to produce sticky ends. So you see the first gene has blunt cut ends, and the second one you make the ends stick out a little bit. They're called sticky ends. Meanwhile, you take a bacterial cell, and bacteria are interesting. They have their regular DNA in the chromosomes, but they have these little things, circular pieces of DNA called plasmids. And they usually confer things like antibiotic resistance. So you take the plasmid, you can use an enzyme to cut it open, and you can use another enzyme or several to make the ends sticky. And then you insert your gene that also has sticky ends, so they bind together. And then you have what you see here, this you have that plasmid with your gene that you want to express in it. So you put that into a bacterium, and you're good to go. Now you have a recombinant organism, in this case, an E. coli. So what are GMOs? Genetically modified organisms. I think Karen covered some of this. It's typically means using recombinant genetics, right? Because evolved organisms or bred organisms are also genetically modified. It just takes a lot longer to do that. Both plants and animals can be GMO. Plants are engineered first because they're easier and cheaper. Animals are being highly engineered now. Chinese researchers recently reported to be engineering humans. Love to hear your thoughts on that later, but more than one gene insertion is called stack traits. That'll be mentioned later. 63% of GMO plants nowadays have engineered tolerance to herbicides, and 75 or more percent supermarket shelves of processed foods contain GMOs, more than 70% of corn, and I think Karen mentioned 94% of soybeans. So how do you make a GMO? It's very analogous. You start with a plasmid, you take it from a bacterium, you put your gene, you cut the plasmid, you put your gene in there with sticky ends, you anneal the plasmid, you put it back into a bacteria. Here's where it diverges. You use the bacterium to put your gene into a plant cell, that's that blobby shape thing there, and then you grow the plant on agar or something, and you get little colonies growing. And you pick a colony and you grow it up as a plant, and hopefully that's the right plant. That process, by the way, of picking a colony and growing it up and then checking it to see if it's the right one, that's actually what cloning means. That's the process of cloning. So hopefully you get a plant when it grows up that has the right sequence in there, which you check for, and if it produces seeds, if it's fertile, then you're good to go. You have your product. So again, I've just kind of gone over this, except the bottom part there. A lot of things can lead to GMOs. It can just be a couple of amino acids that you change, or a lot of different genes, or genes that can be entirely new or constructed from pieces of other genes. How do you detect these things? That's really important nowadays. The way you start is we have an analytical lab in the biocenter. You think about what the difference is, right? What's the difference between a GMO organism and a regular organism? It's got different DNA. So the answer is you're looking for a difference in DNA. The way you do that is with the polymerase chain reaction, PCR. Again, you use these enzymes to cut out the gene that you want, and you add some primers. And I could. So you start with a target piece of DNA here, and you heat it up. And what happens is it comes apart if you heat it up. And then you put in some primers that bind to it. When you cool it down, you add enzymes and nutrients, and the enzymes form two new complementary strands. Now you got two copies of your original DNA. You heat it up and separate them. The primers go back on. You do the same thing again. Then you got four and eight and so forth. When you have enough copies, you can detect it by regular spectroscopic methods. And that's how PCR works. So there are different types of GMOs. Transgenic is different genes from a different species, cisgenic genes from a same or similar species. Subgenic is a new one. That's where you leave all the genes in the organism, but you knock them out so they're not expressed. And I like to think of GMOs as falling into five main groups, you can argue more or less. Herbicide and pesticide resistant GMOs, pest and disease resistant ones, the improved ones, lower cost GMOs, and just the fun ones. So herbicide and pesticide resistance, 63% have tolerance to herbicides, as I mentioned. The first big seller and the well-known one is Monsanto's line of Roundup Ready food crops. It's quite an extensive collection nowadays. They impart resistance to an herbicide called glyphosate, which is a really powerful, potent herbicide. It basically kills any kinds of plants, just about. And so the plants can have glyphosate sprayed directly on them, whereas in the old days, plants, you had to put the glyphosate down low on the plant. If you got it on the leaves, it would kill the plant. It's taken in through the leaves. So this allows you to use a lot more Roundup from Monsanto, whose patent only expired in 2000, and also to apply it more often. So, of course, they were thrilled to have these plants available. Some of the things that are available, I won't go over. There's a huge list. Soybeans, of course. By the way, there's a new generation of Roundup 2. Genuity Roundup Ready 2 soybeans are now available. Why would they want to do that? Well, because the original one, the patent expired, and now there are generic versions. So now they have to have, yeah, something else to sell. Corn is famous. There's a new maize from Dow. This is a stacked strain. It has several resistance genes. Wheat, cotton, alfalfa, a lot of things. This is just a few of them. So we go to pest and disease-resistant GMOs. These typically contain genes from other organisms that either kill insects or prevent them from feeding on them, so-called antifeedant genes or proteins. So corn is a famous one that has the BT gene. The BT is from Bacillus thuringiensis. This is a really amazing soil bacterium. It has more than 200 toxins that have been identified. And so Monsanto took three of them that kill caterpillars and two that kill beetles and put them all into the corn. And corn is deadly to the bugs, and so it grows really well, doesn't get attacked much. And these proteins are expressed mostly in stems and leaves, not in the corn. So you don't really eat it if you're eating the corn. Potatoes have been done, of course. Cotton kills bollworms. Squash is that viruses. Somebody mentioned papayas. There's actually some Hawaiian viruses that natively attack papayas, and so they've, this is a new kind of genetic modification. They took some coat protein and they injected it into the germplasm, the cells of the papaya plant, using the new gene gun. It's literally a gun. It shoots 22 caliber gene bullets, and you just coat your bullet with DNA and you fire it into the cell. The bullet hits a stop and the DNA keeps flying and goes into the cell. Very sophisticated. Another category, enhanced and augmented foods, or improved foods as I call them. So you can improve the oil of canola, tomato, the flavor saver is supposed to last longer so you could ship it farther. That's important because people that don't have food, generally the world is producing enough food nowadays. The problem is getting it to the people who really want it. So in principle, if you can make your food last longer and you can ship it farther, you can help to solve that problem. The golden rice from Syngenta was modified to make it more nutritional. Seems to have failed in clinical trials. They have a new version with beta carotene, and they've given that away to the Golden Rice Project. So I don't know more about where it's at. A couple new kinds of soybeans, higher in oleic acid. So something that's higher in oleic acid, you can cook longer with it. You can get three full cookings of frying in fried food, so we can make cheaper fast food. farming GMOs are another type, not one of my five categories. They fall into other categories. So you can produce drugs in organisms. That's nothing new. Some of the first experiments were done with E. coli to do that. Protogene had a drug that failed. It contaminated some crops, and they ended up paying a lot for it. They're out of business now. FDA in 2012 approved the first plant-based treatment for Gaucher's disease. It was a protein. But it faces a lot of challenges because plants, when they make proteins, you know, they put sugars on them that are very different from the sugars that humans and mammals put on. And so there's been a lot of toxicity issues, and it can cost you a lot to take those sugars off. Thanks. Let me try to hurry. GMO animals. Everybody's heard about the fish, of course, the GM AquaVantage. It has a number of genes in it. It has the antifreeze gene, some growth hormones, and a few other things. The salmon are triploid females, meaning they have three strands of DNA and some other growth regulators, and they're claimed to be fertile. They're sterility knockouts. If anybody has seen Jurassic Park, I forget the character, the tall guy that said, nature will find a way. Turns out 1 in 10,000 are fertile, so that might be a challenge. This was licensed, by the way, by the FDA as a drug, not as a food. They consider it a drug. For fun, right? You're human beings and we love to do things that are fun. So we have cats with bright blue eyes or that glow in the dark, rabbits that glow. The Vietnamese have made a seahorse that glows. And of course, the glowfish that all have all kinds of fluorescent colors. You can do gene silencing, so you can edit, take out genes instead of putting them in. I'll try to hurry up here. I'll just skip over that and that, except to mention epigenetics. So now there's, in addition to inheritance by DNA, right? People are familiar with epigenetics. It's a different kind of way of inheriting thing that's not genetic. And the interesting thing that as of current law, epigenetic changes are not considered GMOs. So a lot of the agricultural companies are rushing to do epigenetic changes to their organisms because if labeling comes, and they all consider that it will, they won't have to label the GMO, the products as GMO because they've been changed with epigenetics rather than with GMOs, rather than with regular genetic manipulations. So obviously we need a better regulatory scheme to take advantage of this, so we're not chasing everything constantly. So are GMOs safe? There was a study a while ago that published, it was a meta study, and it showed 1,700 studies cited, and it said, basically they're safe. The problem with these studies is that almost all of them are severely underpowered. They don't have enough people and they don't look for long enough to make any statistically significant conclusion. In other words, there's no way for us to judge whether they're safe or not. There's just not enough information. We know almost nothing about the safety of GMO foods. That alone doesn't make them dangerous. It just means we don't know anything. So how are we going to be able to determine whether these things are safe? We need another method that doesn't depend on the availability of good studies, because we don't have any. And I want to remind people, because so many people say bad things about GMOs, they have enormous potential to help us. They're just, to me, probably the beginning of a whole industry. And in the beginning of any industry, right, mistakes are made. Look at the auto industry or just about anything. People are kind of crazy, and the companies are doing some perhaps bad things, but the potential for improving health is only starting to emerge. It wasn't that long ago we figured out that H. pylori was behind stomach ulcers, right? In the developed world, there are almost no stomach ulcers. Overnight, in less than 10 years, that happened. Now they're starting to link diabetes to infection with Staph aureus, and it may be that in a few years, type 2 diabetes will go the same way. Changes to our diet might prove critical, and GMOs are certainly going to be a big part of that. So there's a huge potential. And they're being harnessed to deliver therapeutics, and I put in there, would you rather get your medicine by a shot or eat an apple or something to get it in? If we ban GMOs, we're going to foreclose all these possibilities. Worse, we're going to give other countries that aren't banning them a huge economic and medical advantage over us. Isn't there a smarter way to move forward? I'll skip over all the horrible things that glyphosate does. Let me just summarize it by saying it does a lot of really horrible things. Roundup. Yeah, it's basically what the farmers are discovering with Roundup is that it's killing the soil. Those who've been using it for a few years now are going out and finding their soil is completely sterile. It's dead, it's compact, it's dry, doesn't even absorb water very well. And they're starting to get really worried about it. Of course, as scientists, we know why the stuff was becoming less effective, right? They've had to up the allowance of Roundup. They started with a single application per season. They're up to 4 applications in many farms now. They're just using more and more of the stuff, and it's killing the soil. I won't even mention it's used all over where soybeans and corn primarily. What's the best way to regulate or evaluate the risk of recombinant GMO? Coming from the biotech industry, I would say, you know, if regulatory agencies like FDA did this like they do drugs, there's a really obvious way to do this. You clone the inserted gene. So here's a new gene. You want to see if it's safe. You clone it into something that's comparable, that produces the protein in its native form, and then you prepare it the way you would normally prepare it, and you administer it the way it would normally be administered. So how would you administer GMO foods? You eat them. So make them into something you can eat. Just take those recombinant proteins and make a hamburger or make something out of them and let people eat them and study them. This is the obvious way to study recombinant materials. How many times has it been done? It's never been done. Why not? Because it's never been done before. So what should we do if we need to make this ongoing series of decisions going forward? We don't have the kind of information that we need to make good decisions, but it'll likely affect our health and well-being. We're going to need some way to do this. We need a sustainable system for collecting data, right? And here is just the public. It shows the public doesn't really believe that scientists understand everything about genetically modified crops. No kidding. I'll skip over this except to say, look at the first two numbers. It took the world at least 20 years to figure out that smoking was linked to cancer. And it took another 20 or 30 years before anybody did anything about it. Natural methods, people talk about things being natural as if that's preferable. Traditional breeding is very slow, changes occur from generation to generation. Evolution takes eons, it's even slower than that. Both of these are very slow. So what happens is bad effects, people dying from effects, happen once in a while and you don't necessarily notice it. Risk is hard to evaluate generally, and especially with statistics, which you have to use. Think about Russian roulette, right? So you put a bullet in a gun, and you play Russian roulette, and you do it again, and then you stop. Is Russian roulette safe? Yeah, you didn't get hurt. It's perfectly safe. We expect that significant effects from recombinant GMOs, probably going to take 20 years or more to show up as bad effects. We need long-term studies. But long timelines make signals difficult to detect. So I tried to illustrate that here. I couldn't find an illustration. You know how they say white men can't jump? Well, a lot of us can't draw either. So this is like a long signal that rises a little bit and then falls back down, right? It's really hard to detect. Whereas if you go along and you see a really sharp signal, really easy to detect. So the sharp signal could be the sudden introduction of GMOs, and people start getting sick, everybody has a reaction, oh my God, this is terrible. Whereas the natural foods that we eat probably had the same effect, but they had it over a really long time as genes were spread among a population. So it's a small signal and you just don't see it. It didn't happen in our lifetimes. I'm trying to hurry, I'm sorry. So the difference between natural and artificial, think about a new gene coming in to the population. Codes for an existing protein, part of the sequence deleted, so it can fold in a different way, it could cause an immunological reaction. If it arose naturally, it can take thousands of years to spread throughout the population. So a bad effect, again, wouldn't be noticed. If you did it recombinantly, you'd have it within a few years, and so you might see a really quick effect. So farming itself, if you think about it, that's not even natural, right? People talk about natural farming. Getting a whole bunch of things to grow together right next to each other is not natural. Any plant can tell you that. Monoculture farming is even less natural. A single species, it takes an enormous amount of energy in fertilizer and pesticides and tilling. Almost never happens. So the argument to me about natural versus not natural really kind of misses the point. It's not that things are good because they're natural. It's they're good if they're safe and effective. And we kind of assume that they're safe and effective if they're natural, but that's only because the bad effects have been diluted out by time. They've occurred over a long time. And we can also maybe conclude that all the bad things have happened in the past and they're no longer happening in the future, but we have no real basis for assuming that. It's really an assumption, not a fact. We're starting to understand that difference now, I think. Maybe that's where our focus should be. Let's confirm safety and efficacy and kind of put naturalness on the back burner. What should we do? If we're going to focus on safety, we have to be vigilant. We have to watch for signs of danger, not just our foods and medicines, but materials and practices. New materials are being invented all the time. Your car is full of them, for example. You get a bad stomach ache after eating dinner. What does it mean? It could be what you ate, or maybe it's a coincidence. How can you tell? If GMO foods are not labeled, you can't tell. You won't be able to tell what it was. You might suspect, but you have no way of knowing. We have to have GMO foods labeled, not to punish the companies that are making GMO foods, but simply because we need a way to start to correlate reactions to GMO foods with the actual GMO content. And we're not going to be able to count on government studies, and certainly not corporate studies, to show real safety and efficacy, 20-year-long toxicological studies on GMO foods. We're not going to have those, so we're going to be the clinical trial, the people of Earth. We need a way to tell what's going on when we have a bad reaction. Is there potential for misuse? Absolutely. Because the population, the public is not that well informed about these things, and there's going to be a backlash. I'm sure that when labeling is first instituted, a lot of people are just going to avoid GMO foods because they assume that they're bad. And that's just the price that we pay for essentially an educational failure. It might even take a generation or two to get over that. But again, we're just at the beginning of this whole process. We can go for a generation or two and make some mistakes. It's okay. But over time, we just want to get on the right path. It's a step that we need to go through. So I'll go good or bad. Just look at the bottom paragraph there. So whether things are good or bad, you can't really judge until you see that something bad happens or good. We're not in a position today to say whether GMOs are bad, except I think very clearly in the case of pesticide and herbicide resistant strains. I think those are clearly bad at this point, and we probably should be acting to get rid of them. We have enough data now, it's time. But for most of the other types, we just don't know yet. There's not enough data, and there's not usable data out there. So should they be labeled? Most Americans apparently want them. You could argue that certain foods may not need to be GMO labeled. If they are labeled, what should they say? Here's somebody's example of what a label should look like. I find that woefully inadequate. Here are some of the things I'd like to see on a label. What have you put in there? What does it do? Anything silenced, epigenetics, et cetera? That's it. I just want to acknowledge several people have helped shape my thinking on this subject, and also I've kind of brazenly stolen a few slides from them. So I want to thank Brian Rasnow, Panda Kroll, Michael Newman, and you for putting up with my long talk. Thank you.
Boy, thank you. That may have been the most scientifically erudite talk we have had in this group, right? Personally, I can't get past the fact of shooting guns of DNA into the ground. I mean, I think those of us in, maybe it's a new CSI soybeans that we'll be creating in Hollywood soon. Anyways, moving along, I'm delighted to introduce our next speaker, Mr. David Alvarez. David was born in Brownsville, Texas, and raised in Venice, California. I can only imagine the cultural shock between, we can think about that later. He received both his bachelor's and master's degrees in nutrition and dietetics from Cal State University in Los Angeles. He is currently the assistant manager at the Center for Healthy Living at Kaiser Permanente in Woodland Hills, and he is a certified diabetic educator. A fun fact about David is he is about to have his third baby on July 10th. Although I have to amend that, I suppose technically his wife is having their third baby on July 10th. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. David Alvarez.
Good evening, everyone. Dr. Hornstein, I think he mentioned earlier there's a test at the end on all of this information, and if you don't pass, you can't leave tonight. So you won't see any words, you're only gonna see food. So my portion, I'm fortunate, my portion is to address whether or not it matters what we choose. Right, so I don't know if you noticed, but there was a Burger King right on the corner over here, so we can all go together after we're done here. But my approach is going to be much more simple, and it's going to be more wholesome. And so what we're trying to do, my colleagues and I, at Kaiser Permanente, what we're doing is we're shifting away from diets, or using the word diet, and embracing lifestyle. And so there are tons of diets out there, and just based on overwhelming evidence, it really all comes down to lifestyle. It comes down to a wholesome approach. It comes down to everything in moderation, and I'm sure you've all heard it phrased like that before, right? Everything in moderation. And it really is true. We also understand you have to take it case by case, because everyone's relationship with food or everyone's lifestyle is different. So we always take that into consideration. But all in all, it's really about that. And so do our choices matter? Well, it's not Q&A time, but if I may, by show of hands, do our choices matter? What do you think?
Yes.
Oh, you didn't even have to raise your hands, right? So, and they do. So if you were thinking, I was gonna tell you, you can have a cheeseburger or two every single day, I apologize, but I'm not gonna say that. So what is it, Dr. Hornstein, one of the questions he asked me was, what is the biggest problem with health? So in my professional opinion, the biggest problem is we've all been conditioned to want instant gratification, right? So we want quick results. And this is the food industry and other companies, they feed off of that. So we've all embraced that ideal. Well, many of us, I shouldn't assume. But the patients I've worked with over the past 15 years, that comes up very often. Can I lose 20 pounds in 2 days? Can I change the way I eat in 2 weeks? I've seen that happen, but it doesn't last long. So. You've all heard of taking small steps. I'm sure you've heard your physicians and maybe told your dietitians, your nurses. It's very true, and there's a lot of research coming out supporting and speaking to how helpful it is to make small changes. Behaviorists refer to that as successive approximation, so building off of small successes. And it really can make all the difference with making a transition into a healthier lifestyle. So having said those things, have you all heard of the dietary guidelines for Americans? Okay, a few yes, a few no. Okay, so what I'm gonna do is I'd like to go over the highlights. The dietary guidelines, they were just updated, and they're updated every 5 years. And they are a resource, they're a guide, they're a tool for put together by the USDA, the United States Department of Agriculture. And they put together an advisory board, and based on science, they make recommendations as to how we should eat to stay healthier, to become healthier, okay? So let me go over some of the highlights. So the, Mac, have you ever heard of the term macronutrients? Okay, so those are, in other words, those are the three major nutrients that where energy, where we get our energy from food. So can anyone shout out one of those three nutrients?
Carbohydrates,
very good. Protein, and there's one more. Fat, very good. What am I doing here? You already know this stuff, right? So that's right. So they give it to us, that the recommendation is given in percentages. If anyone after the meeting, if you want to know specific numbers, I can calculate that for you. It's based on how many calories someone we consume per day. So every one of you consumes different amounts. Some of you are looking to maintain, so you're consuming a certain amount. Some of you are looking to gain weight, lose weight, et cetera. So your calorie intake will differ. But all in all, and by the way, this recommendation is, for example, whether you're diabetic or not, this is what they recommend. So for carbohydrates, the recommendation is for 45 to 65% of your intake to come from, of your total caloric intake to come from carbohydrates. For protein, it's 10 to 35%. And for fat, it's 20 to 35%. And again, if you want to talk after, I can certainly break that down for you. But that's essentially, in a nutshell, what they recommend for consumption of all major nutrients. Now, moving on to key points. So they're, again, consuming a healthy eating pattern. Again, that wholesome approach, a little bit of everything or a little bit from every food group. So a variety of, have you ever heard of vegetables? Just a few of you? Okay. So guess what? Do you think they recommended to decrease or increase vegetable intake? That's right. So consume vegetables, and something my colleagues and I do is we recommend trying to have a different colored vegetable just to vary it. For the most part, even if you eat the same color, you're going to get the nutrients you need, but some have a little more of certain nutrients than others, so the recommendation is to vary the color. Fruits, especially whole fruits, what do you think? Increase or decrease? Okay. And there is overwhelming evidence supporting the intake of vegetables and fruit. There was a major study that compared the intake of fruits and vegetables, at least five servings of each, at least five or more, it showed a dramatic improvement in health, reduction in heart attack and risk of stroke, compared to like just having two or three vegetables or even one, or a fruit and vegetables. So especially, there are two types of veggies. There are non-starchy and starchy vegetables. Have you heard that differentiation? So it's the non-starchy ones that, they're both in moderation, especially the starchy ones are both, we can eat both, but we really emphasize the non-starchy ones. So as you can see, this first plate here is full of, what's the biggest item on there? I probably already gave it away, vegetables, right? Hey, even with diabetics, I don't worry about non-starchy veggies, to be quite truthful. I have not had a member or a patient come to me and say, you know what, Dave, I really struggle with my weight or my blood sugar because I'm eating so much broccoli. So again, the evidence is there. I know it's easier said than done, but just so everything is clear, that is the recommendation. And something we encourage is to fill half of your plate with vegetables. So you divide it up into four. By the way, do your meals look like this? Oh, I see a lot of yes nods. That's good. Here's another example. What's half of that plate filled with? Vegetables, right? Okay. So you also see the chicken and the corn tortilla. So let's talk a little bit about grains. The recommendation is to get plenty of grains, plenty of whole grains. So what are some examples of whole grains? You tell me. Brown rice, sure. Okay, quinoa, very good. What else? How about whole wheat bread? Buckwheat. Oh, I've got some, or maybe just one gentleman that has really done his homework. Okay, very good. Corn tortillas, etc. Okay, so. Steel-cut oatmeal, etc. So the recommendation, again, going back to the carbohydrates, it's 45 to 65% of your total intake. When it comes to whole grains, by the way, what really stood out, my physician colleagues and I, we collected, we sort of did a thorough research a thorough search of all the research that's been done on food. And one of the things that one of the things that stood out from all the evidence is fiber. So you've all heard of fiber. Okay, so fiber is the part of food that humans cannot fully break down. So what the research has shown is the more fiber we get, the healthier we are. And the specific recommendation by the dietary guidelines is to try to get 14 grams per every 1,000 calories. So I prefer to simplify that and just say aim for 25 to 30 grams per day, no matter what your calorie intake is. Just one suggestion, if you're not used to having roughage or fiber in your diet, I would encourage you to start slowly. If you go from 0 to 30, you might have some bathroom problems. So, dairy, milk and yogurt. The recommendation is fat-free or low-fat dairy. Okay, so then I'm sure you've already known that for some time. Variety of protein foods. And here's what they listed: seafood, lean meat, poultry, eggs, legumes, nuts, seeds, soy. There's overwhelming evidence supporting the intake of or shifting to plant-based foods. Okay, how many of you consume only plant-based foods? Okay, so not too many, not too many. There is a considerable amount of evidence supporting making that shift or that transition to a plant-based only diet, particularly when it comes to protein. So, and one of the things that stood out was red meat and the negative impacts that red meat can have on us. So, just a couple of things, even as little as, say, about 3 ounces every day can put us at increased risk of heart disease. And by the way, I'm talking not just about red meat, I'm also including processed meat in there. So has anyone ever heard of bacon or sausage? I'll take that as a no. Okay. So red meat and processed meat intake, we're strongly encouraging everyone to consider cutting back on or even eliminating red meat or processed meat and replacing it with a protein source, preferably a plant source. What are we talking? Or even fish and chicken without the skin or turkey without the skin. Okay, it's the red meat and the processed meat that worries us. So if you do want red meat, maybe every 7 to 8 years is okay to have. there have been some large studies suggesting that maybe by reducing, you can improve your health by roughly about, one of the major studies said about 9.something percent, you can make improvements in your health if you reduce your red meat intake on a daily basis to maybe about an ounce or a little over an ounce. How many of us have this right here? That chicken is about 3 ounces cooked. As a matter of fact, every protein source that you see up there, that's 3 ounces, that's supposed to be salmon. Those are beans, so this is a entirely plant-based dish. Okay? And guess what? The protein recommendation doesn't change if you decide to become vegan. So what's recommended for protein is that equation doesn't change. It's exactly the same. Okay? And just by combining a couple of things, so protein, beans, and some rice. Have some beans in the morning and rice at night will provide you with what red meat provides you. Okay? Just a couple of other things. Saturated fat intake. Panel partners alluded to like saturated fat and trans fats. The less trans fat, the better. Eventually, they will be cleared out of markets. That might take maybe 2 or 3 years. Saturated fat, it gives it to you in percentage, but most of us are maybe used to grams. So I would maybe, a suggestion, this is general, maybe 8 to 10 grams per day of saturated fat. Added sugar, the recommendation is less than 10% of your total caloric intake. So, and we can, I can calculate some of these for you. And then if I could just give you, or maybe I could save this for the summary. Will I have time at the end to summarize? Okay, I'll save that for the end. Okay. That's it for my part. Thank you.
Our final speaker is a good friend, Dr. Tricia Westhoff-Pankratz. Tricia was born in Laramie, Wyoming, and raised in Bakersfield, California. That would make for an interesting talk at a different time. She received her undergraduate degree in biology at UCLA, a fellow Bruin, and completed her medical school at the USC Keck School of Medicine, a fellow Trojan. She completed her residency at Harbor UCLA Medical Center and is board certified in endocrinology, diabetes, and metabolism. A fun fact you may not be aware of is she is married to my palliative care partner, Dr. Chuck Pankratz, and she has 3 kids, including twin boys. And just to add some excitement to her life, as if it wasn't exciting enough, Tricia just opened a private practice in endocrinology last month on Loma Vista. Ladies and gentlemen, our final speaker, Dr. Tricia Westhoff-Pankratz.
Thank you. I know we're going to try to keep it a little bit brief. I'm not even going to pull up any slides. I can pretty much just talk to you about what I talk to my patients all day long and what I have said for 20 years every day, all day long. A lot. I'm really glad that this talk is sort of transitioned into what I think is the most important topic, because so many times patients come to me, you know, fairly sick patients, type 2 diabetes, heart disease, you know, everything that we've talked about that we don't want you to get. And the huge elephant in the room is that, quite frankly, my patients have eaten themselves to death. And I mean that very soberly, that we have a society that has overeaten to this point of disease. And their main concern is, how can I avoid gluten, and should I have these GMO products? And I'm doing really well, I'm going all organic. But unfortunately, they're eating an enormous amount of calories, and I think they're missing the point that we get so caught up in the hoopla of fad diets and advertising and I don't know what the right word is, that we miss the point that we just need to get back to the basics that Dave was talking about. Lots more vegetables, lots of whole grains, protein, and not worry so much about gluten or not gluten. This is not the enemy. The enemy, I think, in my experience, is that we are just have people who are just are overeating. We have enormous amount of obese patients, not just in an endocrinology practice, but in our society. And it is not just about you, a person who is overweight. It is about our society. It is a very expensive disease. Our Medicare costs, our insurance costs, it is not just about you. It is about what we as a society have to pay to afford the amount of medications. Because I'm probably am talking to the wrong crowd. People who will come here are probably not the ones I need to be talking to. But the reality is that they will, when given the choice, and as we bang our head against the wall and, you know, eating better, exercising, eating better, counting those calories, what's a calorie, what's a carb, over and over again, you know, most of them will just say, I'm not going to do it, just give me the drugs. And that's the bottom line. That's 4 or 5 shots of insulin a day. That's pricking your finger 6 times a day. That's 5 or 6 oral medications for diabetes. That's 10 drugs for blood pressure and another couple for cholesterol, not to mention all the heart medicines and the kidney medicines that their nephrologists and cardiologists have them on. These are thousands of dollars of drugs because they cannot stop eating too much. And I think that that's where we should focus on. And really, if I could get the community with me to understand, we need to move more, we need to know how many calories are you eating. My patients have no idea how many calories they're eating. It comes down to that. You can't eat 5,000 calories a day, and that's what we're eating. If you look at, and I've given this talk before, if you look at, now that we have our calories listed on our menus, and you look at how many calories are in your food, we really don't need to eat, most of us who aren't all that active, more than 1,800, maybe 2,000 calories a day. And if you're trying to lose weight, probably 1,200 to 1,500 calories a day or less. One piece of pizza at Costco is 650 calories. A salad at CPK is 1,200 calories. And if you go and you look at the menu at fast food, don't even go there. I mean, forget it. That's a whole week's worth of calories in one meal. So that's I know I don't have a whole lot of time, but that's pretty much the bottom line. Just forget the fluff. Just move more and count your calories, eat better. Whole grains, vegetables, lower calories, and just forget all the other craziness that we have out there. That's the bottom line.
Well, that was fun, kind of getting right to the point. you know, we do have, if it's okay, can we have about 5 or 6 more minutes of some question and answer before we conclude? Thank you. Okay. So I want to go ahead and actually move to what I call the lightning round in honor of our last speaker. And recently, there were several journal articles in the medical literature, really, that have come into play in the last year that talk about certain things that I suspect many of you have either read about or heard about or are interested in. And what I'd like to do is ask very quickly all of our speakers to say yes or no if they think this is something good that we should eat. Okay, so the journal articles have commented about several things. Number one, what about coffee? Number two, what about fiber? Number three, what should we do about nuts? Number four, artificial sweeteners? Number five, low-fat or low-carb diets? Number six, probiotics. And number seven, what are healthy foods for our kids? So I want to go ahead and start off each question. If you want to take a pass, that's fine. But number one, is coffee okay for us to drink?
I think so. In moderation, I have one cup a day myself.
I think it's great, but I struggle having a small enough amount. So yeah, it's tough to have too little. I mean, it's tough to have enough, not too much.
I agree. I love coffee. Coffee can, even black coffee and even decaf can elevate blood sugar a little bit, and it varies from one person to the next. But all in all, there are some potential benefits to having a couple cups of coffee, black coffee.
Yeah, I agree. Coffee is not bad. Good data showing that coffee is actually not our enemy. And one study showed women who drank 6 cups of coffee a day had a lower risk of type 2 diabetes. So coffee is not the problem. What you put in the coffee, and if you go to Starbucks and you get the Frappuccino Deluxe, that's the problem. But the coffee, the even the decaffeinated, is not a problem. No.
Very good. So 4 out of 4 say coffee is okay. The article.
Thank God.
I own no stock in Starbucks. We should have a disclosure. The two articles I read exactly complemented that 2 to 3 cups of coffee, believe it or not, are healthy. Especially, and this was an interesting subset of, if you are an overweight man with high blood pressure, 2 cups of coffee prevent you from becoming impotent. Which raises the whole new meeting to get up and go, but we won't be talking about that. So coffee, I think, thumbs up.
Thumbs up.
Okay. Nuts. What about nuts?
Nuts are fine, provide monounsaturated fats, as long as you don't eat a whole jar at Costco, I think you're doing fine.
I would agree. I think they're good, except, you know, those really big cans that you get at Costco? God, those are great.
I'm good with nuts, healthy fat, like Karen said. They're filling. There's some protein. Absolutely.
Yeah, nuts are great, especially the raw nuts that they're not roasted and salted. Tons of protein, no carbs, great for our diabetics. We give a thumbs up on nuts.
So 4 thumbs up on nuts.
Dry roasted. Dry roasted nuts.
Dry roasted. Okay, yeah. we're getting more specific. The article that I was sort of referencing actually was a huge study of almost 40,000 nurses and 20,000 other individuals, which showed that nuts decrease all cause reasons for death significantly. So to those of you who are not eating small amounts of nuts, when you leave here, you probably ought to start to consider that. The next question dovetails with what we discussed. What about fiber? Everybody wants to know about fiber. What do you think about fiber? And specifically, if we get away from counting calories, what are you talking about as far as how do we get enough fiber in our diet?
Probably the more the better. I've seen studies 65 grams if you can do it. It's very difficult. And then did you have a second part to that?
No, fiber and how do you do it? 65 grams, what does that mean? To the average person here, anybody know what 65 grams worth of fruit is?
It's a lot.
It's a lot of fruit, okay. You wouldn't be sitting here right now, you'd be at the bathroom if you had 65 grams of fruit.
But again, do it slowly.
Slowly, okay.
I figure billions and billions of termites can't all be wrong, so it's probably good stuff. I think it is, yeah, in a reasonable amount. It definitely probably cleans you out and just pulls things along. It has to have a good effect in that sense.
Absolutely. 25 to 30 grams, that's a reasonable amount to aim for. But yes, the more fiber, there have been studies showing the higher the fiber intake, the healthier the individual. Helps to lower cholesterol. It keeps our digestive tract healthy. Just to give you an idea, Trader Joe's Fiberos, you're getting roughly 8 grams per cup of fiber. On average, like a Quaker Oats oatmeal, you're looking at about 3 to 4 grams of fiber per cup. So it's not that hard to get your 25 to 30 grams per day.
Trish, fiber?
Yeah, so fiber, of course, is obviously very healthy. The problem that we have if you're diabetic is that fiber comes with a lot of carbs, which means a lot of insulin and a lot more drugs. Mm-hmm. So it's a sticky wicket in our world. We would recommend that the fiber be deep greens. Really, that's it for them, because even the fruit tends to be, a tougher thing for them. It just means more insulin and more medication. So, if, for example, breakfast cereal, you want to try to get at least 5 grams of fiber and under 5 grams of sugar. That's almost impossible to find in the aisle at Vons. It's almost impossible. It's really hard to find in a traditional grocery store 5 grams of fiber in the cereal, because most of it just doesn't have enough, and it's loaded with sugar instead. So yes, fiber is of course fabulous. It's just hard to get 25 grams of fiber in broccoli and vegetables, which is what we would recommend.
So the article I was referencing actually stated that fiber is probably the most important one item you could do to lose weight. So if you really wanted to say, what of the hundreds of diets are out there eating 30 grams of fiber a day, which correlates to about 7 pieces of fruits, vegetables, or whole grains, in however you do it, will probably help you lose weight faster than any other diet available. If you want to lose weight and be healthy, eat fiber. Okay, artificial sweeteners. Thumbs up, thumbs down. What? Oh, we're getting a rebellion in the audience here. I'm seeing a lot of thumbs down. Our panel?
I think it depends upon the situation. I could tell you that I was a large consumer of artificial sweets in college. I was much heavier then, and now it's only regular sugar. If you're a diabetic, you know, you could still have 10% of your calories can come from sugar. So it's just fine. Sugar, I mean. Artificial sweeteners, I don't think they're horrific, but I wouldn't necessarily choose them.
I personally don't like them that much. Several of them give me headaches, including the first few that came out, so I usually tend to avoid them. They're interesting because chemically there shouldn't be any nutrition there, so they should be perfectly fine. They just really do nothing. And yet I know that studies have shown that people who consume a lot of artificial sweeteners tend to be heavy, and there's some feeling that that's because they get habituated to sweet things. And it's really easy to switch from the diet cola, oops, you ran out, and then, oh, here's one with sugar, but it's just one, it's not so bad. So I suspect that's really the bad thing about them.
I was going to say the exact same thing. No, that's okay. I'm going to add a few things, though. The FDA considers them to be safe to consume. I'm still cautious when I recommend it. I don't tell people not to have them, but in moderation. So if you find you're having, I don't know, and this is just a recommendation I make, if you find you're having more than 5 packets a day of Splenda, for example, 10, 15, 20 packets, I don't know, I wouldn't be surprised if your arm falls off or something, right? But in moderation, I'm okay with it. Just a couple of other things I want to add. Based the evidence that's out there, what I've come across, the most significant thing they speak to is the weight gain and changes in taste perception. So people desire, because they're so much sweeter, they want to consume. They want to meet that level of satisfaction, so they eat more. And then I've also come across some smaller studies saying people that drink diet sodas, like 2 diet sodas a day, there's a chance of reduced kidney function and depression, prevalence of depression.
Trisha? I think I pretty much would say the same thing. It's that it ups the ante, so they're even sweeter than sugar. So when you go and then you have a regular carrot stick or a piece of lettuce and you're used to aspartame or Splenda, it's going to seem so bland. It's exactly the same thing. It just changes your taste perception.
One of the things in the family medicine literature is that when artificial sweeteners came into being in the 60s and 70s, everybody thought this would be fabulous and everybody would be losing weight because, again, you're taking no calories. It turned out to have been absolutely the opposite, that once we started seeing artificial sweeteners, in fact, everybody got heavier and we started eating more. And we're just now starting to understand the mechanism for that. One mechanism, which again, I should just tell you from our literature, is that the artificial sweeteners are so good at fooling the body, it also fools the pancreas. And the pancreas secretes extra amount of insulin, which of course drives people to eat because their blood sugar may go low. So that in fact, that may be the mechanism why you have zero calories, but you overeat. So instead of eating an 1800 or 2000 calorie diet, you have zero calories, but then you eat 800 calories more, okay? So that's one of the ideas, and the recommendations from most of the primary care physicians are to severely limit artificial sweeteners, and if you are going to want something sweet, take a little sugar. Just a little sugar in moderation. Okay, last question, probiotics. Anybody care about probiotics? Anybody take it? Big, big, big business. It's about a $15 billion a year industry already. Should we be taking probiotics?
Yes. I'm pass
all right,
on
one
that
vote
one.
For yes.
I'm going to pass on that one.
Okay. I think for the current generation or crop of probiotics, I think they can have maybe some effects for some people. I'm not that familiar with them. What I see for probiotics is tremendous potential in the future, because most of the organisms that are being used now in probiotic mixtures are pretty much bland constituents that we already have in us, but they can be engineered to deliver all kinds of things, and I think in the not too distant future that's what's going to happen. I really look forward to that.
I agree. I've seen some, in my experience, I've seen people respond positively to probiotics, and I've seen others where it didn't work. And then I also experienced, because there are different strands, so some people respond more to certain strands than others, so it can get a little tricky finding the one that works for you. But I've worked with members or patients that get them at, there are certain brands they sell at Costco, and they seem to be effective. So in my experience, they're good.
Okay, so I'm not a gastroenterologist, so take this with a grain of salt. But I know that my GI colleagues, I'm going to be the enemy here, really think that they're a little hocus pocus. And unfortunately, they've gotten, they're going in a little bit too much in the trendy realm. There is a place for them. If you've been on antibiotics, if you've had major, you know, bowel surgery and you've been on IV antibiotics and you've killed your natural gut flora, you have diarrhea after that, there is a place, and they do prescribe them if you've been on antibiotics just for an outpatient infection for a long period of time. But to randomly go and take probiotics because our neighbor says it's a good thing to do is getting a little pseudoscience, in my opinion, and in the opinion of my gastroenterologist, who basically, when I have gone to lectures in this regard for doctors, is not highly respected, so don't hate me on the way out of here. But I think we gotta just not get wrapped up in the probiotics unless you really have an indication to do that.
So a little bit of controversy on probiotics. I should tell you, in the family medicine literature, for adults, exactly like Tricia said, we really don't know. There are specific cases. Certainly, if you get super infections after getting antibiotics, there is a place for them, especially Clostridium difficile, which could be life-threatening in the hospital, and there's all sorts of new movement there. However, I should mention to you, not many kids here that I could see, but there was a very interesting article in the pediatrics literature that says for daycare children age 6 to 36 months, so these are very small, that giving a dropper of probiotics daily lowered significantly their risk of diarrhea, antibiotic use, ear infections, and colds. So again, I think, as Tricia said, this is an area that's brand new in healthcare, but stay tuned, because I think there's going to be some really interesting stuff on the horizon. In this particular case, to those of you who have kids or grandkids, you may want to have them talk to their pediatrician about probiotics for all daycare children. So with that, what I'd like to do is conclude briefly. As is our custom, each speaker will have 1 minute to offer their concluding remarks in reverse order. Dr. Westhoff, it's your soapbox.
Oh, goodness. I think I did it. I'm good. I think you got my message. Let's just eat better and move more.
David?
Mine's a little longer. I have three. This is what I wanted to share earlier. So if I could give three pieces of advice, it would be this. Eat plant-based food most days. Get most of your fluids from water. And there's a fad out there. It's called exercise. So move more and don't sit too long. Every hour you should probably stand up for 10, 15 minutes.
Doctor. Yeah. Dr. Kosha?
I would say the debate about GMOs is really interesting. I think a much bigger threat to most people's health is simply processed food, which in some ways has accompanied the GMO trend. And I would be much more worried about processed food. And I personally struggle to cut that out and eliminate as much as possible. So I think that's probably worth worrying about a lot more than the GMO foods. And these big political trends and debates will take their course. I don't think they're really as important to each of us individually. That's it.
And Karen?
Picking up on Greg's statement there, so watch the trans fats. Those are processed foods. The GMOs, I think there's a lot headed on the horizon. The only caveat is I think we should know what we're eating. We have the right to know what's in our food. And in terms of the gluten, don't date anyone that's gluten-free. If you have further questions, we do have a very robust outpatient dietetics counseling. It's actually, I have pamphlets out on the table. We have some very qualified dietitians who work with you. It's not going to be done overnight, they're wonderful dietitians, and they work really hard, and they care about their patients. So thank you so much.
Ladies and gentlemen, if I could just have 1 minute. Firstly, please join me in thanking all four of our wonderful guest speakers. They did a terrific job on a very complex topic. I'd also like to again appreciate and thank our sponsor for this evening, the Community Memorial Health System, who have done a wonderful job at bringing the science and the medicine that's going on in our hospitals and our health systems to you, the community. So thank you for this opportunity. Finally, I would like very much to invite all of you to our upcoming fall programs, which are just being produced. In September, our first program will be, and I apologize, it's slightly provocative, Are You a Good Patient? And if you're not, maybe you should become one. So that we will be discussing in September, Are You a Good Patient? And then in late October, our second, which is probably even more provocative, Red, White, and You, the American election through a healthcare lens. And we will be able to evaluate the candidates and the positions they're taking in the election, which will be happening a few weeks later from October, about what it means to us who are interested in healthcare. So ladies and gentlemen, I look forward to seeing you in the fall. In the meantime, have a wonderful summer. Thank you all for coming, and good night.